Those issues that are critical for the health of our society and the impact of science and technology to join us. You've picked up perhaps the literature outside, if not access the website, very simple website to access, www.c2st.org. So that is my pitch, so to speak. Now I would like
John Grunsfeld is one of Chicago's very own. Born in Chicago, he attended Highland Park High School. He received a BS degree in physics from MIT, then returned to Chicago for graduate study, receiving a master's and PhD degrees from the University of Chicago, where he was a Granger Fellow in experimental physics. After postdoctoral experience at Caltech, in 1992, he was selected by NASA for mission specialist training. He is a veteran of 5 space missions, logging more than 58 days in space and over 58 hours in 8 spacewalks. With nearly 20 million miles of space travel, as a member of NASA's Frequent Flyers program, he is now entitled to free upgrade to the next available class of service on any future missions. In 1999, 2002, and 2009, he participated in missions to repair and refurbish the Hubble Space Telescope, named for famed University of Chicago astronomer and graduate Edwin Hubble. John is a hero to the astronomical community. Without the efforts of John and his NASA colleagues, we and the public would not have Hubble's remarkable eye to reveal the mysteries of the universe. John has received many honors and recognitions, but I'm sure the one he is most proud of is the Distinguished Alumni Award from the University of Chicago. The university, indeed all of Chicago and the country, is proud to welcome him back home to present Hubble's story. Please welcome John Grunsfeld.
Chicago, and also the campus that we have, with Art Institute of Chicago, the Civil War Institute, Abbott Planetarium. It's a very active science program, the Field Museum. And one of my favorites when I was a kid, the Museum of Science and Industry is a great place to learn about science. This is what it's going to look like in a few months in Chicago. This is actually a picture that I took in 1997, February of Chicago. But just to set sort of the scene, this is what it looks like from space. And somewhere about here is where we are now. This was from Space Shuttle Atlantis. I've flown out Atlantis twice. This time we were docked to the Mir space station. And this is what I looked like in 1967 at 55th and Kenwood during the great snowstorm of 1967. But at that time I was already interested in going outside and building snow caves and out exploring. And about the same time, perhaps randomly, but Mrs. Lowe, my third grade teacher, asked me to do a biography of Enrico Fermi. And that was one of those pivotal moments in my life when I learned about another great explorer, Enrico Fermi. He was a mountaineer who loved climbing the Dolomites. He was a fantastic experimental physicist, of course, the originator of the first atomic pile under Stagg Stadium, Stagg Field, the stadium at the University of Chicago, which I got to ride my little bike over and see before it became Regenstein Library. But he was also a great theorist, and we all, as an Italian-American physicist, have debt of gratitude to him, and I do as my hero, basically, as I was growing up, becoming a scientist. This last May, I got to go on my fifth adventure to space. In this case, it was back to the Hubble Space Telescope. On that 1997 mission, I called Car Talk for advice. I was pinned as a repair person. We had a very rookie crew and a very experienced crew going to Hubble this time. Scott Altman, the commander, was on his fourth space flight and his second to Hubble. He and I flew together in 2002 as well. And he is perhaps most famous as a famous film star. How many people have seen the movie Top Gun? Good, quite a few hands. Well, there was some two-bit actor in Top Gun who had top billing in flying F-14s against Russian fighters, and actually Tom Cruise did not fly those jets. The Navy pilots, Fairmont Films paid the Navy for the operation of the aircraft carrier, and the pilots for flying the jets, plus you know a little bit of a stipend for the pilots. Scott was Tom Cruise's stand-in, and because he didn't have a speaking part, he was not asked to join the Screen Actors Guild, and he got paid as an extra $15 a day. I think Tom Cruise probably got paid a little bit more. And there's a famous scene, I don't know if you remember, of an inverted F-14 and then a Russian big fighter in a negative 2G pullover or something like that outside. And Tom Cruise, Scott Altman actually, Scooter we call him, gave a friendly gesture to the Russian fighter. That was Scott's finger. Mike Massimino, on his second space flight, his second flight to Hubble also, he was another returning veteran from our STS-109 mission in 2002. Myself, of course, I was the lead for the spacewalks. And then we had four rookies. And by loading the deck with experienced Hubble folks, we were able to fly first-time flyers, and they all did a great job. Our pilot was Greg Johnson on his first flight, obviously. He's a Navy pilot with A-6s. Megan MacArthur, a PhD oceanographer from Scripps, UCLA. Was our flight engineer and robotic arm operator. My spacewalking partner, we did five spacewalks. I may call them EVAs at some point, extravehicular activity, back and forth. So if I say EVA, that means spacewalk. He was my spacewalking partner. We did EVAs 1, 3, and 5, spacewalks 1, 3, and 5. And Mike Good, and Drew is a geologist, exploration geologist at Exxon, Queens, PhD from Queens University in Canada. And Mike Good, the Air Force colonel, radar intercept officer. On his first mission, he was Mike Massimino's partner for EVAs 2 and 4. So we blasted off in May, basically to do a complete Hubble makeover. We were going to put in new scientific instruments. Two of the scientific instruments on Hubble had failed, and so we were going to try a first ever in situ in orbit repair by pulling out circuit cards and putting in new circuit cards. I'm going to show you our home movie. So there'll be a bunch of things. You get a launch scene, grabbing Hubble, going out between spacewalks. And when we do the spacewalks, you'll see me removing some tiny screws. I had to remove a cover plate that had a little tiny number four screws on them. And then we do the same thing on another instrument. And then we put on some new computers, new batteries, gyros, and then closed up Hubble and set it up this way. So it's really a brand new telescope. So here we are at the Kennedy Space Center. We have to have two space shuttles. You see Atlantis and Endeavour there. Endeavour was our rescue ship in case something went wrong. That's when the here we are walking out in our launch and entry suits of protective gear. We had to make sure we went to the right vehicle, and two, the bus took us to Atlantis. So there we are, fully loaded with fuel, 4.5 million pounds of explosives. And we're climbing in. It's a little bit of a tight fit. That's Greg Johnson, our pilot, called Ray J. Megan was the last one in. Afterwards, they closed the hatch. There are about 10,000 people that all have to do their job right for us to get over successfully. Flight director in Houston getting the
code. Mr. Grunsfeld, because of live, on behalf of the KSC processing launch team, I'd like to wish you, your crew, the whole Hubble Space Telescope team, a great mission. Good luck, guys. We'll see you back here in about 11 days.
And that's the launch director in Florida. The main engines turn on about 6 seconds prior to launch, so they're running. Then the solid rocket motors light, and then we're going somewhere. That was our first master alarm. That's not a good thing. At this point, I'm wondering whether we're going to make it to Hubble. Right about here was our second alarm, and then it got a lot more serious, and we were all a little bit more quiet. I'll tell you what they were after the film. But the ground said no action. That can mean a couple of things. One, there's nothing you can do about it, or it's not a problem. After 2 minutes, we get rid of the solid rocket motors. That's a view from the cameras on the solid rocket motors that will re-enter and will splash in the ocean. And there we are, heading off to orbit on the large orange tank that had the liquid fuel in it with hydrogen and oxygen. That'll burn up in the atmosphere over the Indian Ocean. Once we're to orbit, we open the payload bay doors. I'm always amazed after rocking and rolling like that, it's floating out, broken pieces of objects and things. And the next couple of days, we were chasing Hubble. Basically, we're now going 17,500 miles an hour, about 600 kilometers, 350 miles above planet Earth. Catching up with the Hubble Space Telescope. I hadn't seen it in about 7 years, but it looked pretty good. Megan reached out with the robotic arm and grabbed it. It's got almost flying formation with it. And Hubble looked like it was dead still when she grabbed it. It was really amazing. In the meantime, we were turning our rocket ship from a rocket ship to a house on orbit, a place to work, getting all our tools out. We had over 400 specialized tools to repair Hubble. This is a power screwdriver. Getting the spacesuits ready, that's my helmet going into the airlock. Getting ready for flight day 4 when we do our first spacewalk. These are liquid cooling garments, that's what keeps us hot or cold, temperature control. Drew was eating a Cliff Bar there, last meal before going out into space. I'm saying hello to my family. And here I am, flight day 4, coming out of the airlock. My sister often asks, do I work in a vacuum? And I say, yes, I do. Drew had that big grin on his face, which he kept the whole time he was outside. Well, almost the whole time. The first bolt we had to take off on an old camera wouldn't turn. We were afraid we were going to break it. And so he had to apply a little extra elbow grease.
Okay, here we go. Take a gun. It turned. It definitely turned. Yep.
So for about 20 minutes or so, we weren't sure we were going to get the old camera out, which would have been an incredible disappointment for the scientific community. But we did get that bolt. It broke, it came free just before the failure torque, which would have snapped, and we never would have gotten it out. So there I am within the telescope, pretending to be Edwin Hubble. I didn't have a pipe, though. I always had a pipe. And this is the old camera coming out. These cameras are amazing digital cameras, and they push state of the art. The reason we have great cameras here on Earth are because of efforts like this. This is the new camera going in, and I'll show you some images from that. It's basically a 16 megapixel camera. I'll describe why it's great. Typically, we have one person on the end of the robotic arm, the other person floating free, so that was me floating free. Here, Drew is putting in a new spacecraft computer. The reason we actually delayed, I didn't describe this from October to May of this year, was because a computer broke, so Drew's on the end of the arm. I was installing a docking adapter on the bottom of Hubble, and here you see the view of my helmet, looking at Hubble with the reflection of the Earth, and Drew's working on a latch there to finish off VA1, so here we're coming in on the arm. So Megan MacArthur is flying that robotic arm. In the payload bay, we have all the containers that hold the scientific instruments. Between EVAs, we have to change out hundreds of tools. There's one specialized screwdriver, and also the space suit. So it's a flurry of activity. You work really hard, and then you go to bed and wake up and do it all again. So this is Mike Massimino now. Mike Good, they're handing out the tool board that contains all those tools. This is the airlock. I'm looking down on the robotic arm. For this day, the main task was to change out some tiny gyroscopes on Hubble. And normally that's a pretty straightforward thing. We had, again, some troubles getting those gyroscopes in. They're behind these big doors. On the first servicing mission, when they went to close those doors, they wouldn't close. And again, it's a telescope, you like it nice and dark inside. We couldn't close the doors, and that would be the end of the telescope. So we learned sort of a mantra, don't break the telescope. I always try to do that. So this is Mike handing out one of these bread box size gyros. Now Hubble is a really great telescope for a bunch of reasons, one of which is it's not a particularly big telescope, but it's above the Earth's atmosphere. And so it can see things that we can't see down here on Earth because of the shift in atmosphere and because ultraviolet light doesn't get through the atmosphere. This is Mike Good, thrilled we put in the first of six gyros. The next two didn't go so well. And those gyros, though, are the other reason why Hubble is a great telescope. They're very, very sensitive, and they allow Hubble to point and stare in one position at a very distant part of the universe for a long period of time. After 6 hours of a 6.5 hour EVA, we were done with the gyros, and we got to go to continue and change the batteries. On this mission, batteries were included. They're not little AA batteries. They're these big 380-pound nickel hydrogen batteries. Really amazing. They've been up there for 19 years. They're about 25 years old, and they get cycled once in orbit, which is 96 minutes around the Earth. These guys, after 8 hours, still relaxed. That's at the stage for EVA-3. EVA-3, this is me going out, and the big task was to change out something called the COSTAR, which was the corrective lenses, the contact lenses of Hubble that we put in 1993 that corrected the wrong shape mirror, and then to try and repair the advanced camera for surveys, the same one of those repairs I mentioned. We opened the big doors. This is the COSTAR coming out. I convinced Drew that he should work out in the gym every day for 3 years to be able to hold this 800-pound instrument, the size of a big seltzer refrigerator, of course, in orbit, it's all free-floating. But you still have to start and stop it and be able to control it. And here we are putting that instrument away. And Drew did a great job. We then put in the new spectrograph during our night pass, and we don't really see it. So now you'll see me inside of the telescope. This is Drew helping out like a surgeon's assistant as I remove these tiny screws. Many people have said this mission was dedicated to the study of behavior of tiny screws in space. And there's a fair amount of truth to that. We actually employed a kind of neat trick. We had a cover plate that had holes in it that were small enough for the screwdriver to go through, but not big enough for the tiny screws to come out. So we got all those screws out, and there's the circuit boards I had to remove. They made one with a funny angle. I actually couldn't see all of this. I was working around a corner, so a lot of it was just by feel. Unfortunately, we developed a technique and got these cards out. I wasn't allowed to touch them. There were about 50 things. They said, oh, you can't touch that, it'll rip your space suit. I said, well, what about here? And they said, no, you can't touch that, it'll rip your space suit. But we developed some neat tools. There Drew's got the old circuit boards, or actually the old cover plate in there, in the way. And here we are coming over the coast of Baja, Mexico, coast of mainland Mexico, finishing up with that ACS task. And we had allotted 7.5 or 8 hours for this, and it turned out with all the practice I did and what we did as a team, this was exactly on target at 6.5 hours, and I was pretty happy. In fact, I was so happy, I slept really well that night. The next morning, Megan, after the alarm clock went off and music played, I was still sleeping. She says, I think he's dead. But I had about 3 years of stress relief that day, EVA-3. Eating in space, everything in space is fun and magical. I like to be upside down like a bat. Drew likes to eat in the corner, but he has kind of a unique way to prepare his food. He's preparing a chicken tortilla. Kids don't try this at home. I'm saying, I'll try it at home. It's a good demonstration for Abby. Enjoyed that. The spacewalkers, we got plenty of exercise. The guys inside had a bike that they can ride to get exercise. Lots of bodily functions, you know, that we got to do in space. Another example, I don't know what this is. if you don't cool in a minute. So this is Ray J describing. This is the tube that you key down, you know, for solid material. It goes in here. And we're very environmental friendly. We bring all that back to Earth. We don't leave it in space. We did have some problems with the orbiter on board. We had a humidity separator. It takes humidity out of the air so that our breath doesn't cause a lot of humidity buildup. And it was leaking, so we went down into the belly of the beast into the orbiter. And this is all the avionics. This is the humidity separator. Underneath these ribs is about 2 millimeters, 2.5 millimeters of aluminum, and then the tiles, and that's it. This is the skin of the orbiter. On the other side is a vacuum. So here's Scooter cleaning up that water. It was a lot of fun going inside. This is an experiment I did for as a national pathfinder for a company called BioServe in Colorado. Salmonella vaccine is what they're working on. And I finally can say I actually did science where all I had to do is turn a crank. I'll talk a little bit more about this later, but we actually had a replica of Galileo's telescope on board from a museum, the Science Museum in Florence, where Galileo was from. And all I can say is he was an amazing observer. He's a really bad telescope.
Now it's time for our favorite segment, which is
Senior Yen.
Likewise.
High Corner.
And your Scooter's Corner. He's actually in his real corner.
So that's the flight deck of the orbiter. Mike Massimino, believe it or not, wants to be a talk show host when he goes up. So he shot all of us after the EVAs and sent them down live to the ground so anybody who followed the mission would see Scooter's Corner. But there he is demonstrating that maneuver from Top Gun. We actually testified to the science subcommittee of the Senate, Barbara Mikulski's committee, from orbit. That was a lot of fun. She could see us. And apparently when we deployed Hubble in the cabin there, between EVAs, we had to get access to different sides of the telescope, so Hubble was put on a turntable. We would rotate Hubble around. Hubble's about the size of a school bus, 45 feet long, about 14 feet wide. On EVA 4, we tried the second instrument repair, again, taking out tiny screws. And even before we got to the screws, one of the big bolts got stripped. Right here, you can see it getting stripped by the power tool. We had to remove that yellow handrail before we could get to all those tiny screws that you see there. And for about 3.5 hours, we couldn't get that darn handrail off.
Sunset in 11 minutes.
And we really thought it was going to be a showstopper until somebody on the ground came up with a good idea.
Yeah, we're ready. Okay, that's it. Look how we go.
So in about 60 pounds of forest mass, just Mike Massimino, Tom Mass, just broke it off. I said, that I can do. So that led the way then for us to start the EVA, basically. And this turned out to be another nail-biter, 8 hours. And here's another one of those cover plates that has tiny holes in it that the screwdriver would go through, but the screws wouldn't come back out. So you'll see Mike Massimino installing that. And then taking the cover plate off with the tiny screws, pulling the circuit card out. We now know what had failed. It was a common component of both these instruments. And, the good news is they're both working now. And then coming back in the air. Fortunately, we were successful on that. And on the 5th EVA, Megan picked up again with flying the robotic arm. And on this EVA, we were going to change out the second battery. This time, I'm on the end of the robotic arm. And here I am coming down to meet Drew. Foistel, who's holding that battery again, all that jib time paid off. You can see I'm holding a tether. You know, we don't let anything go untethered, so we can lose it. And then we also put in a new fine guidance sensor. And this is one of those other tools that allows Hubble to stare in one place for very long periods of time. About the size of a baby grand piano, about the same weight. Very easy to handle in space. As part of our complete makeover, we also put new insulation on the outside of the telescope. To give it more longevity. Hubble's been up there 19 years. A little bit of luck, we should make it another 10 years. And really amazing, we got everything done and a little bit more that we planned on in our time. I gave Hubble one last tap, said good luck on your voyages, and back in the airlock. And that set stage for the Hubble deployment. Again, we lifted it up on the robotic arm, and then got ready for Megan to let go. And then Scooter was going to fire the orbiter jets in the nose to back out from under Hubble. And that's the least we can do, least perturbation, least disturbance to the Hubble Space Telescope as we move by. We don't want to do all this work and then blasted with the jets. So this was our new exciting thing.
You realize if you really got that.
I'm going to select every second.
5 seconds, the switch is in auto.
Believe it or not, there's 7 people on the flight deck.
Release.
That's not somebody's cell phone. It's a timer. Well, there's a leg timer.
Clear again. Mode switches in off.
So once we're clear, just put a little fire to the gas. I've seen this 3 times now in 2 missions. And bang, bang, bang. Out we go. And it's really amazing because every time we deploy Hubble, everybody ducks. It's 11 feet above the cabin. It looks closer. And I can tell you it looks a lot closer. But I mean, what are you going to do if it's going to hit you? Ducking isn't going to help. And then everybody gets the camera and the last one to film in. And now you can get a sense of a few more people. So here we are. This is Africa, center in Africa, the Hubble Space Telescope. The good news is the aperture door is open. It's ready to do science. Once we deployed Hubble, we actually got ready to do a part of our deorbit burn, which was a safety measure for us. So that's Greg Johnson firing the orbiter jets. And this is probably the last time human eyeballs will actually look at Hubble during the sunset. And the next time we saw it, it was very distant, just a little bright star on the horizon, and we didn't see it anymore because we were in a different orbit. So here we are doing our deorbit burn. There's an orbiter floating in space. It's a shot of the toy. And that put us in an orbit instead of circular, a very elliptical orbit down to 160. And here, that's the coast of California again, perhaps. Once we deployed Hubble, we had time to have some fun. Some people say stupid astronaut tricks. I like to do physics experiments. That's Tang. This is the first time in 5 missions that I ever got to play in space like this. We had a couple of wave-off days with bad weather in Florida. And so I got to do all those physics things I always wanted to do. We also have video games on board while I was down there doing physics. Scott was playing video games with Ray J and flight engineer Megan. It happens to be a landing simulator. I was actually glad that he was practicing. And there's the date about how he did. We did this for about an hour or so for each of the crew members. Then we got Scott up in his suit, and then he got out of his suit, and then he got in his suit the next day, and then he got out of his suit. Finally, on the third day, we got him back in his spacesuit, and this time he looks like he's ready to go. He's rocking some tunes, thinking maybe we'll get waved off again. Megan's thinking, I don't think so. And we did come in that day to Edwards Air Force Base in California. This is actually the shuttle encased by about a 2,500 degree plasma as we ionize the atmosphere coming in over the Pacific Ocean. It's nice to come in at night because you see that. And then finally back in daytime, we saw Edwards a few hundred miles out. And Scott Altman's job was to put the orbiter, the space shuttle, over a particular runway 200 feet wide by 15,000 feet long after being a glider for about 5,000 miles. It's a pretty impressive feat. First thing you have to do is get the landing gear down. It was Greg Johnson's job at about 300 feet. And then after traveling about 5.3 million miles, the scooter hits it right on the head, which is good because there's no engine. You have one chance to do it right. Anything other than that is disaster, quite literally. We deploy a parachute so the nose gear doesn't hit too hard or slows down. 197 orbits of the Earth with Hubble's basketball, we came to a stop. And that was a couple months before we knew whether Hubble was working or not. Unfortunately, it did. We didn't break the Hubble. We didn't stop back in California. So I now have a bunch of slides, but that will really culminate in what I want to show you some of the early results of our Hubble. So we can go back to the slideshow. First thing I want to say is being in space, being in Earth orbit, it's just an incredible experience. It's very contrasting, very beautiful, very magical. This is, again, Drew and myself in the telescope. But here's our beautiful planet Earth. And what you're actually seeing here is the terminator between night and day. As we orbit the Earth, we go around once every 96 minutes, so we can see this 16 times a day. And of course, the Earth, we see it once every 24 hours. It's also a contrast in terms of temperature. These spacesuits, wonderful spacesuits inside, we have pure oxygen at 4.3 psi, so inflated like the Michelin man. That means we actually do have to do work against the suit. Ben, and this is me pulling out that guidance sensor. And we see temperatures from minus 200 degrees Fahrenheit to plus 200 degrees Fahrenheit, as does the Hubble every orbit. That's why this insulation gets crinkly and why we replaced it. But it's also a place that's really not meant for humans, yet we thrive there to do things like repair the Hubble and astronomy. I had a chance after the end of the EVA to pull out a camera and look back at the orbiter and take some pictures from space. And I said, hey, Drew, do something interesting. So there he is. Standing on his head in space. I suppose that's interesting. We had a chance at the end of 5EVAs to say a few things before going in. And you can see here's two very happy guys. This is the reflection of the Earth and our visor. I really can't say enough about what a unique experience, amazing experience that is that we get to go to space. Really a sign of a great country that we live in, that we support things like this. Support doing this job. While I was at Caltech, I really wanted an office with a view. Right before I got selected to be an astronaut, I got a corner office with a view, and then a month later left. But this beats them all. This is Megan's office. Really incredible to be able to look out and see planet Earth going by. Other unique things you can do in space, you can float in the middle of the cabin, this picture of Drew. And contrary to what you may have heard, astronauts really are different. We do get to put our pants both legs on at the same time. I love taking pictures of planet Earth. I'll just show one example because I really want to get to the Hubble pictures. But this is the coast of Africa, right? West coast of Africa. Right here is one of the Cape Verde Islands. And there's a strong southerly flow of air. And there are these little lanes of vortices in the clouds where the wind goes over the island. Fills in the back. These are von Karman vortices, or you know, whatever you may call it. But really just beautiful to be able to look out and see these kind of things on such a massive scale. I also, as I said, got to do a little bit of physics tricks. I wanted to make these water balls, and I'd always wondered, you know, what it would look like to focus on the water ball image of somebody in the background. So we had fun with that for a while. You can see Drew is holding a straw that we used then to drink that water. And I said, Drew, get really close to it. There's actually an analog of this and dark matter lensing of distant galaxies and gravitational lenses. This was my simulation of gravitational lenses. As I said, we had Galileo's telescope on board. This is the 400th anniversary of the use of the telescope for astronomy. 400 years ago, Galileo turned a telescope just like this, made with the same. This telescope was made with the leather from the same cows in the same field, with the same cows, with the same family of cows. The glass for the lenses and the grinding technique was a period glass from Italy, and the wood from the same type of trees. The problem is this telescope at about a meter long was too large to fit it in anywhere in the space shuttle. So it's in the Florence, the Science Museum actually cut it in half. It's one of three replicas made as a period instrument. Put in threads so we unscrewed it and put it back together. Mike Massimino, who's an Italian-American, will return that to Florence this December. And we tried and tried and tried to do astronomy with this telescope. Of course, this is a daytime shot. We tried at night. And you could really only see anything right in the center of the view, and even then it was pretty fuzzy. So I can tell you Galileo was a very patient observer to be able to see what he saw. He was the first one to actually look out and see the faces of Venus, the moons of Jupiter, mountains and canyons, and craters on the moon. And in a way, started the scientific renaissance at the time by challenging the current ideas. And that's something that the Hubble Space Telescope and other astronomical observatories have allowed us to do. Well, finally, we had to, as I said, set up the suit warehouse, get into our space suits, and come home on Atlantis. What I'd like to do now is show you some of those Hubble early release observations. And there's no question that the universe is much more varied and much more beautiful than I think we ever imagined. And Hubble is kind of our eye on the universe. Now, these observations were picked not necessarily to discover new science. In fact, everything I'm going to show you, well, not quite everything, but most of them I'm going to show you, has been observed before, either with very large ground-based telescopes or by Hubble. This was to characterize the observatory and verify that everything worked. tell you that Hubble is a monochrome, a black and white telescope. Every picture it takes is actually black and white, but we put colored filters in front of the camera and then take sequential images in red, green, and blue. And also we'll take another image that may involve some specific physics. This is a particular light that comes from hydrogen atoms to add some science into it. And then we put all of those together to create the images that you see from Hubble that look like this. So this is a galaxy that has a telephone number with general catalog 6217. This happens to be taken with a combination of that advanced camera for surveys that we fixed and the new wide field camera. It's a galaxy much like our own. It has a very central, dense bulge of stars. In the center is a supermassive black hole, and then beautiful spiral arms. This one's a little different than our galaxy in that in the spiral arms, you see regions where there's a lot of brand new stars being formed. They don't live very long, and they're very active and tend to end their lives in supernova explosions. Fortunately, we live in a very suburban galactic arm, so it doesn't happen very often. It's nice and quiet. But this was really wonderful for me to see because of approval from the instruments support and we fixed the Hubble. Now, what you see here is a galaxy filled with stars. In the foreground, we're looking through stars in our own galaxy. You can see those characterized with little crosses. That's a diffraction pattern in the telescope. So anytime you see that, that means it's something in the foreground. Everything else is something at great distances. Okay, so here's one of those calibration images. This is actually something called a globular cluster. It's a collection of about 10 million stars. It's called Omega Centauri, Omega Cent. It's about 10 million stars. And these are, for the most part, very ancient stars. They're about 10, 11 billion years old. The globular cluster is a spherical ball of stars. They were all formed about the same time. And our galaxy has a bunch of these little satellite globular clusters orbiting around them, so we may have actually captured those. And the color of the stars tell you a little bit about how massive they are, what temperature they are. And so the yellow stars are very much like our sun. Now, there probably aren't very many planetary systems, if any, in globular clusters. But if there were, the sky would be about 100 times brighter because these stars are much closer together than the stars around us and the Milky Way are. So this picture is almost a stellar laboratory, and 25 years ago, this would have been a PhD thesis or two or three or four buried in here, because there's all sorts of interesting physics. Stars do collide occasionally, and it re-energizes these old stars and turns them into very blue, hot stars, called blue stragglers. So we can study how stars evolve, and this is getting back to those fundamental questions. How did the solar system form? How did the galaxy form? These are laboratories to study that. Of course, then there's also the view, for instance, of our pilot, Greg Johnson, who's not a physicist. And he said, wow, looks like Christmas. And it does. Talking about where stars form, this is we call it a molecular cloud. It's actually a dense cloud, if you will, of hydrogen gas and other gases. And the colors, I told you about red, green, blue filters. These colors are actually picked to select specific elements. So this is a picture that's taken. It's in the Carina Nebula. You can see it from the southern hemisphere. It's in another spiral arm, so we're looking quite a distance away, a few thousand light years. And in the middle of this dense cloud, and these colors represent sulfur and nitrogen and oxygen, in the middle of this dense cloud, there's a new star forming right here. Now this happens to be what's called a Herbig-Haro object after the two astronomers discovered it. Its catalog number is 666. Which led some astronomer to label it the axis of evil. But for another reason, there's sort of a jet of material coming out here, and it extends all the way out like this. Now, off screen, there's a very massive star that produces lots of ultraviolet light. And like lighting up a fluorescent bulb, it's lighting up this nebula. So there's a lot of ultraviolet light hitting this, causing these atoms to glow. They're the sulfur atoms, doubly ionized sulfur. And it's also boiling off this material. From the outside, you see it wind, if you will. So this is a stellar nursery. Now with this new wide field camera 3 that we put in, this super duper digital camera, we don't just have the ability to look at it in the optical hole as an optical telescope like our eyeballs. We also have this new infrared channel. And the neat feature about the infrared channel is that it can penetrate through the dust. It's a long enough wavelength that you can look through this. And when you look at it with the infrared camera, boom, here's this star, and here are these jets. And so this is a stellar nursery. and there's a bunch of other stars. So I'm going to flip that for just a little, so you can see how that works. So this is a neat new feature on Hubble that's going to give us the ability to explore in very dense regions. And probably, there is a disk of dust around the star, and that dust is coming together and forming a new planetary system as well. We now know about 400 planets outside of our own solar system, and it looks like planet formation is a natural part of star formation in these dense clouds. Now eventually, this star is going to get hot enough that it will create a bubble here, and the ultraviolet light will push out material, and this star will become visible in a few thousand to a million years. At the other end of the spectrum is what happens to stars when they die. This is a star that's about five times the mass of our sun, and it's running out of hydrogen fuel. And as it dies, it kicks out its outer envelope. It's probably rotating, it probably has a disk up here, and it's rotating rapidly, and that accounts for the asymmetry. And over the past few thousand years, it's had a couple of major eruptions. To give you an idea of the speed of this gas is traveling at about 500,000 miles an hour, 850,000 kilometers an hour. Material was flowing out from the Earth this fast, it would only take about 20 minutes to get past the moon, so it's really cruising. With Hubble, we can study in detail these various shock fronts and how this evolves. Our sun probably won't end up like this, but many stars will. This is generically called a planetary nebula. This one's named the butterfly nebula or the bug nebula, because of its kind of wings. And this is how most stars will have, a few solar masses. Times the mass of our sun or so will die. And I really encourage folks to go online. You can just do a Google search on Hubblesite.org and look at these in detail. Even looking at it on this Mac screen, it's amazing how much amazing detail there is. It would be very hard to imagine trying to paint something like this or imagine. And there are thousands of these that Hubble has taken and studied. Quite a much longer distances. This is an astronomer named Stefan in 1800 observed this quintet of galaxies. There's one here, this nice spiral galaxy. There are actually two here, a fourth one here, and a fifth one here. These three are actually all about the same distance, at about 300 million light years away. This one's only at about 40 million light years. And you can actually start to see a little cosmology. These being farther away, they're a little bit more red, and a little more yellow. In this galaxy, also a spiral galaxy, you can see these star formation regions. And Hubble has the ability to look and resolve individual stars in these galaxies. These two are of particular interest because they're in the act of colliding. And in that collision, there's a gravitational disruption. These long tails of gas are going out. And in those tails of gas, new star regions are forming. And they'll become little dwarf galaxies and fly off. And that cosmic dance will go on for a couple hundred million years or so until these merge to form a much larger galaxy. The black holes will merge. Not to alarm you, please don't rush for the exits. And we are going to collide with Andromeda. We're on a collision course with Andromeda Galaxy, and it will be one of these collisions. Lots of interesting things will happen. Fortunately, it's a few million years from now, so I don't think we really have to worry much about that. One of the other cameras, new instruments that we put into the cosmic board's spectrograph, it's a little hard to see, but another thing very massive stars will do when they're at the end of their life is blow up as a supernova. And this is a supernova remnant, a few thousand years old. It's kind of a spherical, what we're looking at is a bubble. The star was in the middle. This gas is expanding. And with a spectrograph, we've taken a picture of this little region. And what a spectrograph does is like a prism break light up into its component colors. And so wavelength is essentially the same as color. And by looking at how much intensity there is in each color, we can actually identify what chemical elements are in this gas. So at this point, I want everybody to take a really deep breath. And one more, why not? I won't make you pay for the late. All of that oxygen that you just breathed in, and all of the carbon that we're made out of, was formed inside stars. We actually have some experts in the audience here. In the Big Bang, the universe was created. We created hydrogen, a little bit of helium, a tiny bit of other stuff, lithium and other things. Everything that really we depend on, if you want to know where did we come from, we came from inside of stars, the stellar furnace, where turns hydrogen and helium into carbon, nitrogen, oxygen. All the elements up through iron and a little bit of heavier stuff, but everything heavier than nickel was actually made inside of a supernova explosion and had to be then sent out into space. And so we'll be able to study that with COGS, the cosmic origin spectrograph. But it's kind of neat to think that our bodies had to be processed, in other words, born in the center of stars, and then those stars had to explode. 2 to 3 supernova explosions in order to account for the composition of our bodies and the Earth and the planets in our solar system. Pretty neat stuff. Now look back at your vitamin bottle sometime. Now, if you believe the marketing that those are actually required for life, that's one thing. But there's a lot of heavy elements in there that all came that we need for various enzymes and chemical processes that come from supernova explosions that we're made out of. We really are star stuff. This is actually the first picture that we took with Hubble after the complete makeover. It's a picture of Jupiter. It was taken July 23, 2009. And the reason this was taken is because an amateur observer in Australia spied this kind of dark region down here. Now, 15 years ago, comet Shoemaker-Levy 9 plowed into Jupiter. As it went in, it broke up into pieces, a string of pearls. We saw those collisions make a huge scar on Jupiter. And we thought, wow, we are so lucky that we've launched the Hubble. And then given the optics were bad at first, we were able to repair it on the first servicing mission. And then we got to see Jupiter in this once-in-a-lifetime, once-in-a-100-year event in Shoemaker-Levy 9 in Jupiter. And we saw the amazing devastation as those plowed into Jupiter, that they burned up kind of in Jupiter's atmosphere, turned into dust, and scarred Jupiter in huge waves going out, much bigger than the Earth. Well, it turns out those aren't 1-in-100-year events. They're 1-in-15-year events, approximately, because another one, we didn't actually see what it was. Something a few hundred meters across hit Jupiter and made this dark scar. This is actually the ash from that object in Jupiter. And you might say, well, that's very nice. Now, why do we care? And the reason we care is that's the same scale as the size of the Earth. So, earlier this month, something about 10 meters across entered the Earth over Indonesia. It's not outside of Asia, but wasn't very widely talked about, and set off the nuclear test ban detectors all around the Earth. So about a 50 kiloton atmospheric explosion when this 10 meter object, 33 feet across, burned up and blew up in the atmosphere. It came in and then started slowing down like the Space Shuttle, but it's not in good shape like the Earth. It actually didn't have Scott Alton driving. And so the pressures caused it to burst apart. This huge 50 kiloton air burst. This was much bigger, and if this had happened, you know, we wouldn't be here most likely. If that had hit the Earth, that would have been a climate changing dinosaur type event. Not really a mass extinction, but we'd all be in big warm coats, and the sun would be blotted out, and all sorts of nasty things like that. And let me just editorialize for a moment. Scientifically interesting, but also that was accessible to everyone, not just me. and this it'll be publicly released. But I'm looking at Tycho. It's a crater on the moon. It's a relatively large crater. And it was formed about 95 million years ago. And in geologic terms, 95 million years ago is yesterday. Certainly in terms of astronomical terms, the universe is 13.7 billion years old. This Hubble Space Telescope helped determine very accurately. So 95 million years ago is not. Now, 95 million years ago, in an auditorium kind of like this, a team of dinosaur astronomers were attending a lecture on the formation of Tycho. And it was fascinating to them because they could look up in the sky and when whatever it was that hit Tycho, about a kilometer across, the moon about doubled in apparent size. There were meteor showers every night for months. And bits of the moon, about the size of a fist, were raining down on the Earth. Now, if you were a dinosaur 95 million years ago and a big rock came down and crashed, there would be a lot of noise, fire, big crater. You know, the first one you would have said, ooh, that's scary. And then the second or third in a few days, for weeks, you would have identified that as a threat. Those dinosaurs had 30 million years to evolve asteroid reflection, space flight, live on Mars, shelters, climate change controls. 30 million years to be able to address that threat. And they chose not to. And 65 million years ago, they were wiped out by another. Instead of hitting the moon, it hit the Earth. And so the point of that fun video is, here we are, we have challenges on Earth. We have climate change that we are certainly causing. There will be winners and losers, but far more losers than winners. And we can be smart about dealing with these challenges. We still have the asteroids threat. So I'm a big believer in space exploration, but also in the human spirit, that we will use our talents the way we have to fix Hubble to also address these challenges. So I'm very optimistic that it's going to be a lot of hard work, and it's going to take everybody to do it. And it'll result in a much better planet. The Hubble story, though, really isn't coming to an end. That was the last Hubble servicing mission. The last time Hubble's basketball will probably be an active play on orbit anyway. But the Hubble story actually is just beginning, and that's because for the first time we have a Hubble with all new instruments, all this new capability. And every time we've had that in the past, we've had some amazing discoveries, and I'm looking forward to that next one. So thank you very much.
Says that science is adventure with a purpose. And I think John shared with us this evening both the adventure and the purpose. A remarkable, remarkable time. John has agreed to answer some questions. There are microphones up at the top here so that everyone can hear the question. Can people please come up to the microphone? Fixture on this mission to be able to do that.
either boosted up to a really high orbit that we don't worry about for tens of thousands of years, or aim it so that it will land in the Pacific for a long term. Otherwise, that big piece of the Hubble would come down or something.
Let me ask a question. Being the scientist that you are, and considering the universe is never ending, do you believe that there could possibly be intelligent life other than Earth here on Earth?
Well, I think the more important question is whether there's intelligent life on Earth. But at the risk of making all these great people who have lined up to ask some cancer ask questions, one of the capabilities we restored on Hubble, the Space Telescope Imaging Spectrograph, is really phenomenal. When we launched Hubble, we didn't know about any planets outside of our own solar system. While Hubble was operating, we observed Pluto, Charon, and two more moons of Pluto, and we demoted Pluto out of planet status. But in the meantime, we've discovered over 350 planets outside of our own solar system. And this Space Telescope Imaging Spectrograph actually has done an amazing feat of observing one of these planets as it goes in front and behind its parent star. And so a little bit of the light is blocked out when it's in front and goes back when it's behind. And Hubble has been able to observe, as a result, the atmosphere of the planet around the nearby star. So we've actually been able, from Earth, to look at the atmosphere of a planet around a nearby star. By restoring this instrument, we're going to be able to increase the number of planets that we can do that. Now, on that planet, it was a big Jupiter-like planet. We saw sodium and maybe, you know, and normal things that we expect to see. Maybe a little methane, which, you know, these gas giants are full of methane. But imagine when we find an Earth-like planet around a nearby star and do the same trick. And if we were to see, you know, nitrogen, carbon dioxide, oxygen. If we were to see non-equilibrium, a lot of oxygen, we could infer that there's some process going on like life. Now, we couldn't guarantee it. But what if we saw fluorocarbons, you know, and other pollutants in the atmosphere? Then we could, seriously, we could confirm that there's life on the planet, and we could rule out intelligent life.
John, just seeing you out there exposed in one of those spaces, I would be petrified of space junk and the little bits of debris that just keep getting pulverized into smaller and smaller pieces. What are the statistics? Have there been any incidents with astronauts getting hit by space junk or by, you know, the space shuttle getting any serious damage from the space shuttle?
So we have a lot of experience with this on the space shuttle. We have experience with it on the Hubble Space Telescope. In fact, on one of the large dish antennas, there's a hole about an inch across with something zipping through and just pulverizing it. On the space station, we have this International Space Station. It's been up since parts of it have been up since 1998. We can see where it's been hit. We've actually put out experiments to evaluate this. The long duration exposure facility was up for almost 10 years. And so we see that these things are, you know, hit constantly by little bits of space debris. It's actually a little bit surprising, given the number of spacewalks that we've done between Hubble and the International Space Station, that an astronaut hasn't gotten hit by it. But fortunately, we go out for 6, 7, 8 hours at a time, and the rest of the time we'll take it inside. Almost every shuttle flight, when we get the space shuttle back, and the teams go around and inspect it, we find something that's been, you know, hit. Very often we have to change a window because it's been hit. You don't have that little super glue suction cup thing. I'm from Texas. People get dings on their windshields all the time. They're stressed. And, so that it is a problem. We've just been lucky.
Yeah, and I just had one question. What was the alarms? I think you said there were two alarms. One
of them was on your slideshow. Yeah, the first alarm, thank you, Greg. The first alarm was actually a flight control channel. We had an electrical short. And when the main engine started, it shook some little piece of metal that caused a short in an electronics box that controls the flight controls on the shuttle. Actually, a pretty serious problem. Fortunately, the designers put four of those systems in parallel. So all we did was ignore one channel. And I guess they felt like they were kind of flaky when they built the shuttle, so they decided we needed four. And actually, it's because it's such a critical system. It has four, and a computer votes on the best three. So that wasn't a big problem. we weren't sure whether it was a false fail or an actual short, and we found later it was a short. But if it had happened even a few seconds earlier, the main engines were to shut down. And we'd probably just be launching now, right now, every time it would take to reschedule the mission. So it was good that it happened just late enough that we still launched, and not so serious that it was, we had the redundancy. The second alarm was actually a little bit worse. It was a liquid hydrogen level sensor, pressure sensor, that indicated actually that one of the engines was failing. And it happened early enough in launch that had it been a real failure, they would have had us do a maneuver called return to the launch site aboard, which means we get rid of those solid rocket motors, and we turn around, fly into our rocket plume, and try and get back to Florida before dumping the tank and landing. It's a theoretical procedure, never been tested. And the community split about, seriously, about 50-50 on whether it was survivable. But it's, you at least try. And we actually thought we were in that case, because there's a sensor that failed not by just disappearing, you know, like maybe your gas gauge. If you're driving along and you have 3/4 of the tank, all of a sudden it goes to zero, you can pretty much figure that the gauge has failed or the sensor has failed. If you're 3/4 and suddenly goes to full, figure it's failed. And if you were to watch it carefully and it weren't to move at all, you'd figure it's failed. But if you saw it slowly going down and shaking, you know, as it goes down, you might think, I have a leak in my gas tank. Well, this particular gauge failed by slowly, you know, shaking and going down, which is exactly the signature of an engine failing. And when they said no action, we were thinking, well, either it's a bad sensor or they're saying there's really nothing we can do about it. And as soon as the engine does fail, we'll declare this return to launch site abort. And we won't get to Hubble. This was a tough time to get to Hubble, because from 2004 to 2006, there was no Hubble mission. It had been canceled. I know Professor Mike Turner in the audience experienced some of that while he was at the National Science Foundation. I happened to be at NASA headquarters at the time. And I think everybody was stunned. It really is that the community, the scientific community, and the public, Congress rally that Mike Griffin, the next administrator, was able to put it back on the manifest. And I thought after all that, I'm not going to make it. Fortunately, it was a bad sensor.
Good evening, John. You talked about the color filters that were placed in front of the Hubble actual camera and how the different color pictures were taken and then combined at the end. As a layman who never went beyond Astronomy 101, I could help under. What do those galaxies actually look like, if we could see them with naked human eye?
That's a great question. Some of them look like what the pictures look like. If they pick, you know, red, green, and blue filter. In fact, does anybody have a digital camera in their hand? Okay, so there's one right there. That camera actually has a similar CCD, chargeable device, image detector to Hubble. And the manufacturers have put tiny little red, green, and blue filters around each pixel. And so there's actually 3 pixels for each. You know, when you say I have a 12 megapixel camera or a 10 megapixel camera, you actually have 3 little colors for each of those pixels. And so they put those filters permanently on the camera. On Hubble, we get to pick those filters one at a time. And so if you pick a red, green, and blue filter for a Hubble image and mix them in the right ratio, you could see the galaxy as if we could see it, except that the human eye, the Hubble, is about 10 orders of magnitude more sensitive than the human eye. So, you know, it's very faint. But you know, if you have really sensitive eyeballs, you're seeing in those colors. Some things, though, are very different. We'll mix infrared color and ultraviolet color that we don't see at all. And we do that because that brings out the science that we particularly are looking for.
Up until a couple months ago, I used to live in Florida, and I've seen all 5 of your shuttle launches from the Kennedy Space Center. I'd like to ask a question. Is, you've been on the shuttle a number of times. How do you feel about the shuttle program ending?
It's a great question. We've flown the shuttle since 1981. We've lost 2 orbiters. The Space Shuttle system, space transportation system, is really the most phenomenal assemblage of equipment we've ever put together for space travel almost any year. It is one of the most complex each of our visits, servicing visits, we've been able to reinvent the telescope. First time to repair its optics, bring new instruments, and on subsequent trips, really renew the telescope. So we've not had one Hubble Space Telescope in essence, but we've actually had three or four space telescopes enabled by the robotic capability, the big payload bay, the people who go out in spacesuits and repair. On the other hand, it is an aging system, and I think it's quite wise that we complete the assembly of the International Space Station and repair the shuttle before we lose another one. It's very hard, very expensive to maintain the level of safety that we've been able to maintain, even then we've lost two crews. So what we're looking at in the next generation of rockets is to build things that have also great capability, slightly different focus, but much, much safer. We're shooting for basically 10 times safer.
Good evening, John. I've heard that you're related to Max Adler that started the Adler Planetarium. Is this correct?
Actually, I don't think that's correct. My grandfather was the architect of the Adler Planetarium, and so he and Max Adler, of course, built the Adler Planetarium, and after a trip to the Zeiss factory in 1929, on a steamship on the way back, my grandfather sketched out the design. Approved it, and off they went.
Okay.
First planetarium in the Western Hemisphere.
The big question is, the Apollo astronauts saw flashes inside their capsules. Of course, there wasn't any shielding, and the flashes, they said, were the particles from the solar wind. As you were in space, did you see these things, and were you protected from them, and how did that affect your body?
I was going to say, yeah, they were crazy. But in fact, I have seen those flashes. All astronauts have the capability to see those. Typically, though, it takes about 30 minutes for your eyes to darken out in a dark room. The same thing is true in space. If you go to sleep at night and wear eye shades and earplugs, as most astronauts do, just because of 16 sunrises and sunsets a day, you can see a lot of that. Other people make strange noises. People snore in space. People have wondered that. So earplugs. But once your eyes are dark adapted, you start seeing the cosmic rays. And these are mostly solar cosmic rays. They're protons moving at very, very high speed, some of the close to the speed of light. And galactic cosmic rays. And our eyes are little cosmic ray detectors, so they can be seen. There's really not anything that you can do to shield against these within reason. In fact, if you were to do something like lighting inside of the space shuttle with lead, it would make it worse. Protons would hit the lead and spallate, sort of explode, create more cosmic rays. So it's actually one of the neat things, having gone to the University of Chicago, got my PhD in cosmic ray physics to see this and experience it firsthand. I was trying to classify singly charged particles and heavier nuclei, which ones are scintillation and which ones are turning off light by their color, things like that.
John, this mission, were you able to take a little time to look at the beauty of the Earth or the Milky Way at night? And do you hope to go into space again to enjoy those views?
I'll answer the second one first. The question was, would I like to go to space again? I would love to go to space again. I think my chances are vanishingly small, just because of the number of astronauts, and then we are moving to only some flights to the International Space Station. The next vehicle really probably won't come online in 2017. With five space flights, I'm way at the end of the line. And on this mission, because we have two weather wave off days, I actually have time to do a star party for the crew and point things out. Took some star pictures, set up a camera, long exposures, 20 seconds, 30 seconds. That's a fun right now.
I have two questions. How far back in space and time can I see? And the second question is, do you think amino acids came from comets or meteorites?
So, great question. Recent observations with Hubble have seen, and for those folks that mean something, have seen probably redshift 9 galaxy, certainly 8.8 or so. Which means we're looking back, so the universe is about 13.7 billion years old, that's pretty firm, and we're looking back to around 12.8 Hubble's now with this new camera peering back. So when we first put Hubble up, we got the Hubble Deep Field. This was a region in the northern hemisphere that we looked at. Bob Williams, then director of the Space Telescope Science Institute, knew was not a very heavily populated region. There was stuff there, but it wasn't a lot. So we spent 11 days to look at that field, and there were thousands of galaxies that came out. How many people have seen that Hubble Deep Field picture? Wonderful picture. Then when we put the advanced camera for surveys in, we did something called the Hubble Ultra Deep Field. Again, we looked for days on end in one region. We saw tens of thousands of these galaxies, and much closer to the first galaxies that formed in the universe. Now with this new wide field camera 3, what took 11 days to do with Hubble, which is precious time, we did in 10 hours. We did the deep field in 10 hours. And now we've continued to add on to that and discovered these very early galaxies. We're going to do that in what's called super duper ultra deep field. But that's part of the program that's ongoing. And so we think we'll be able to see back to about the first 700 million years of the first galaxies will form. The next telescope, the James Webb Space Telescope, will launch in 2014, which is an infrared telescope much better suited for studying that very early universe and actually even further back, maybe at the time the first stars had cleared out enough stuff that you could see them from here. I think it's just amazing that here we are in 2009, we have telescopes orbiting the Earth that can look back. Actually unravel the history of the universe. Pretty phenomenal. The second question was about amino acids, and I think it's pretty clear that wherever we look in the galaxy around us, we see organic molecules in these clouds. And meteorites are filled with organic molecules, comets. It seems ubiquitous that there is organic material out there. So it's very likely that in that early phase of the solar system, a lot of stuff is drinking out on the surface of the Earth. Now, there's some peculiarities having to do with the polarity of molecules that we're made of. It could be a light processor, because in space they tend to be all polarized equally, left and right handed, you tend to be just one. But it's very likely that a lot of early life components came from space, because chemistry in space is going on the same way it does in the laboratory. We see all those organic molecules and amino acids. And we've seen at least one amino acid that we're made of. So we really are made out of star stuff.
Good evening. First of all, how honored and privileged we've all been to have you here tonight. To your knowledge, do we have anything in space which is in a geocentric orbit which can stop, change direction three times, shoot off in the opposite direction, out of sight in the space of 2 seconds, and not be seen? And the reason that I ask you is because while I was in Napier, New Zealand on New Year's Eve 2006, New Year's Eve, waiting for fireworks to go off, I noticed what I thought was a satellite, pointed it out to my wife and a gentleman standing behind me. And while we were all looking at it, it stopped, changed direction, zigzagged three times, went off in an opposite direction, not to be seen. And I turned around and said, please tell me that you all saw what I saw.
Actually, every time the space shuttle launches, I can tell you about my experience. We carry enormous amounts of ice up with us. And that ice hangs around the orbiter and slowly spreads out for days on end. And it's just incredible to see, you know, something that you don't know how big it is. You can't tell how far away it is. And these things do, as they're sublimating, they'll actually build little jets and things, and they're rotating. And since you can't tell how far away they are or how big they are, your brain tries to figure that out from some cues. And you're in orbit, there are no cues. So your brain can just invent stuff. And so we see UFOs all the time. We see weird behavior of things that once you get out the really long lens of the binoculars, so far it's universally turned out to be ice on your orbit. And so we see a lot of things. We also see other spacecraft while we're in orbit. Rare, but if we're going into a night phase, we can still be in daytime, but looking across the terminator, so that Earth is black underneath, but a satellite with high altitude will still be in the sun. So we'll get to see that. So I'll see all sorts of interesting other spacecraft. But I've never seen anything quite the way you've described it. On the other hand, hard to believe that a spacecraft would travel across the galaxy, taking, you know, for us what would be many, many lifetimes, arrive on planet Earth, land in a New Zealand farmer's field, pick up a cow and a farmer, dissect them, put them back, and then leave, and not become the artists from Chicago here.
Subject of the next in this series,
water and oil. So I encourage you to come and hear that. The striking thing is that everywhere I've seen on planet Earth, virtually everywhere I've seen, you can see the imprint of humans and how they change the environment. And that's not an understatement, it's just an observation. Zooming into DC, actually, when you fly over DC, they picked a different kind of lamp for their street lamps than Maryland and Virginia surrounding them. And so you actually see a little square box as the light changes. Actually, being in the middle of those lights 3 weeks ago, I think it was, for the first star party in the White House lawn, it was really thrilling. We had 20 telescopes, we had about 150 kids from Maryland, Virginia, and in the district. Really, really great kids. Very interested in science. I had one of my EVA gloves, and the sparkle on the kids' eye when I found the EVA glove was wonderful for me. I could see them. I didn't expect that. The president did do some observing, and we had a little inflatable dome that he went in and got a little star talk. He came around and touched the moon rock and a Mars meteorite that we had, and a bunch of other stuff. He said some really wonderful things about education. Science and technology education. A whole other soapbox. All I'll say is we are now educating the first generation of young people who will be less well educated than we were. We have to change that. That's without question. That should be one of our highest priorities, and the president talked about that. So I think that was just a wonderful event. Thank you for asking.
Let me say again what a privilege it is for the Department of Astronomy and Astrophysics to partner with C2ST and with the School of the Art Institute of Chicago. I think it has been a magic evening. And what a great privilege it is to have John Grunsfeld come home and share his adventures with us. Let's thank John.